On Indianapolis This Week, gearing up for the General Assembly. The man in charge of the Indiana House of Representatives reveals his plan for the short session, charting a new course for mental health care. The new plan from Governor Pence.
The country went in the wrong direction from institutional care. There were problems with that system.
And is Donald Trump leading the GOP to a brokered convention? Indiana's Luke Messer on what may lie ahead in Cleveland.
From RTD6, the Indy Channel, this is Indianapolis This Week with Rafael Sanchez.
Thank you for joining us. You can find us right now and join our conversation on Twitter, our official account at Indy This Week. And we start with the upcoming legislative session. Several major issues waiting for lawmakers, including what happens with education and the fight over the state's civil rights law. I spoke with House Speaker Brian Bosma on what he expects to happen when the legislature gets back to work.
The State House will soon be open for business. The road to the 2016 legislature involves the future of funding for state highways and bridges. The governor has proposed a $1 billion plan. I asked House Speaker Brian Bosma if that's a done deal.
It's a done deal that it's top priority. I actually announced last April that it would be our top priority this year. The governor's plan that he put on the table is a good start. It acknowledges that we all agree that it's an important issue. You can't claim to be the crossroads of America and have crumbling infrastructure. Our goal is to find a responsible, a comprehensive and sustainable solution, and we're going to have a very healthy discussion about that this year. It's going to be House Bill 1001, our most important initiative, and we're going to talk about a whole variety of state and local funding options, both short-term and long-term. My personal goal is to get the sales tax on gasoline into the Motor Vehicle Highway Fund over time. I've announced that, supported it in the past. That, among other options, many others are going to be discussed.
Bosma says those dollars must be dedicated to state roads.
Well, that money will stay in Indiana. It's collected currently on every gallon of gas, every dollar's worth of gas that is purchased. And that sales tax, with the exception of 1 cent, goes into the state's general fund coffers. It's an important funding source. It's one we'll have to look how it can, over time, be placed completely in the Motor Vehicle Highway Fund. But when people buy a gallon of gas at the pump, they expect those funds to make their way to the roads and bridges of our state, and that's our goal.
The speaker is also well aware of the complaints about the state's high stakes test.
ISTEP's a damaged brand, and we need to take a hard look at alternatives. They aren't as easy as they may seem. Grabbing an off-the-shelf test may not meet the federal requirements that Indiana is under with our waiver from No Child Left Behind, but we are actively looking at solutions, working with the Department of Education, the superintendent, and others to try to find a reasonable testing mechanism that can assure that our kids are learning well, teachers are doing a great job, but doesn't take so much time.
It's a short session where the debate about civil rights protection is expected to grab attention. But Bosma says that will not distract the House from their priorities.
Well, it's not an announced priority for our team. I've made our pronouncement about priorities on Organization Day, road funding, education issues, and meth and heroin issues. But I also acknowledge that we do need to have the discussion and try to find the right balance between two very strongly held Hoosier values. One, we don't like discrimination of any kind against anyone. And two, we place a very high premium on a freedom of conscience and religious protection. So to find that balance for Hoosiers, where the vast majority of Hoosiers can stand, I think is the goal. If it can be done, the Senate is entertaining a bill. And we've been part of the discussions in its formation. We'll continue to work with all Hoosiers, with all different perspectives on it, to try to find a solution.
You've seen the debate. Is there a balance anywhere in the nation? Is there somewhere that we could say it's worked there or there or there that we could at least employ? Or is that solution not even available to you to say that's a model state, or, you know, we can copy that and find that, strike that balance?
Yeah, a lot of folks have pointed to the balance that occurred in Utah, the Utah Compromise, as it's called. We have a little different situation here in Indiana without a singular, dominant religious organization in the state. So they had a kind of a unique circumstance there. But I know that's where Senator Long and the Senate looked first to try to find a model. And with some special Hoosier balances to it. So it, as I said, it's going to be difficult. It's worthy of discussion. I made two commitments in regard to this. The number one is that to the extent I can control it, it will be a civil discussion, which hasn't always been the case from both the extremes. And second, that we won't be forced into a important public policy decision by out-of-state interests.
A busy session ahead, it sounds like.
It'll be busy, but it'll be fast. It's 10 weeks long. If a bill doesn't make it out of the first half after 4 weeks, it isn't eligible for adoption for the rest of the year. So I've told people to buckle up. It's going to be quick, but we're going to be sure it's successful, that it's on time, that it's under budget, just as we have in recent years.
Mr. Speaker, thank you so much. As always, we appreciate your time.
Thank you, Raphael.
And so here's the vision of Indiana Democrats. Lawmakers are pushing a road proposal of their own, a $2 billion plan to fix state and local bridges and roads. It calls for using all of the state's gasoline tax and sales tax on fuel purchases for road construction for the next 4 years. Democrats are also pushing what they call the four words and a comma change to the civil rights law, adding sexual orientation and gender identity. Also this week, the governor heading into the new year promoting a new state-of-the-art mental health hospital. The $120 million project will open in September of 2018 in Indianapolis and focus on mental health issues and illness and drug addiction. The governor telling me the country went in the wrong direction when it closed many mental health facilities.
Governor, I used the word crisis. Is that the correct adjective? Do you see it as a crisis, or is there a different word to characterize the issue of mental illness and the drug addiction that we're not only seeing in our state, but across the country?
I think it is a crisis. I think as I've traveled around the state, just a week ago in Spencer, Indiana, I spent time with five mothers, two of whom had buried children who'd suffered from mental illness and overdose, and three of whom had children that were continuing to struggle with varying degrees of either drug abuse and addiction, or even in some case, mental illness. The frustration that families feel in our big cities, in our small towns, with the lack of access to adequate care, somewhere they can go, somewhere their family member can go to receive treatment, to deal with that mental health issue and deal with oftentimes the drug abuse that attends it and addiction that attends it is a great source of frustration. The reality is, as prosecutors across Indiana have told me, is oftentimes the only place that they can send someone who's caught up in drug addiction or reflects mental health issues is to jail. And as you heard today, it's heartbreaking to think that 50% of the inmates that are incarcerated in Indiana prisons today struggle with either mental health issues or substance abuse issues. I mean, the state of Indiana's prisons, sadly, are the largest provider of mental health services in our state, and that's just got to change.
Governor, thank you. He has dominated the Republican presidential discussion for months. Will Donald Trump's campaign mean turmoil at the Republican National Convention? We'll talk about that next on Indianapolis This Week, right here on RTV6. Turn our attention to the race for the Republican presidential nomination. And this week, talk is bubbling up about the race, lasting until the convention next summer in Cleveland. The candidates on stage again this past week in the final debate of 2015 on CNN. Plenty of focus on frontrunner Donald Trump, including testy exchanges with Jeb Bush.
I think it's very sad that CNN leads Jeb Bush, Governor Bush, down a road by starting off virtually all of the questions, Mr. Trump this, Mr. I think it's very sad.
Look, the simple fact is, if you think this is tough and you're not being treated
this
fairly,
this isn't tough and
imagine
easy.
Imagine what it's going to be like dealing with Putin,
always as
or dealing
easy
with
as
President Xi, or dealing with the Islamic terrorism that exists. This is a tough business to run for president.
I know, you're a tough guy, Jeb.
And we need to have a leader that is
real tough.
You're never going to be president of the United States by insulting your way to the presidency.
Well, let's see, I'm at 42 and you're at 3, so far I'm doing better.
Doesn't matter.
So far I'm doing better.
And that debate continues, Trump again indicating that he will not run as an independent. Now, we talked about them last week and on Twitter. Let's show you what we found out, the Bellwether research poll that shows that Donald Trump leading in Indiana, a poll taken during and after his comments on banning Muslims from entering the United States. It was also taken before this week's debate. Senators Rubio and Cruz tied at 17% and Ben Carson in fourth place with 16%. With the Iowa caucuses a little more than a month away, there's already talk of a potential brokered convention for Republicans in Cleveland, where one where no candidate would have a majority of votes on that first ballot. Joining us now is Congressman Luke Messer. Welcome to the program. Good to always have you. On this issue of becoming a delegate for this convention, we're talking about possibly a brokered convention. We're not even close to the conventions for either party. What is going on?
Yeah, I mean, right now you're in the midst of a very competitive presidential election. I think it's highly likely the race is still competitive by the time it comes to Indiana in May. In fact, it may be competitive all the way to the convention. Each individual delegate is bound on the first ballot in the election. But if no candidate gets a majority of those delegates, then you could go multiple ballots as the Republicans try to select their nominee.
But we're hearing about this brokered convention in light of the rise of Donald Trump and Ben Carson. Is this talk really about going after or defeating a Donald Trump nomination or a Ben Carson nomination?
Yeah, I don't see it that way. I believe if somebody actually gets a majority of the presidential delegates, they'll be the Republican Party's nominee. I just think a lot of folks are looking at the landscape, and when you see Ted Cruz leading in Iowa, Donald Trump leading in New Hampshire, nobody really penetrating even 30%. I think you look out at the landscape and you could see something that mirrors the election 8 years ago of President Obama with Hillary Clinton. That's not the way it was for decades, but now I think we may well have a competitive convention.
But Congressman, what we're seeing in the national polls is that Donald Trump is leading, and much of the establishment is very much afraid that while Donald Trump can sort of raise the base when it comes to a general election, that he may not be able to win the White House. And so a lot of the talk is, if he is the nominee, how do we get the one that can actually be electable?
Well, I think it matters who the next president is, so we need to nominate someone who has a chance to be.
If he's your nominee,
well, the process will have to prove that. I think, though, the way the media has characterized it, when somebody's out there getting 25% of the vote, that's a whole lot of the polling if everyone else is in single digits. But it's nowhere near a majority. To be our party's nominee, you have to have a majority of the delegates across the country. I believe competition works. Churchill once said this is the worst system of government known to man except for all others. And, you know, so I'm not saying this is perfect, but I think competition will prove it out. If we don't have somebody who has a majority going into the convention, then we're going to have to figure it out in the convention. And I want to make sure we nominate somebody.
So correct me if I'm wrong, because this talk of brokered convention, even before the conventions occur, sounds to me like the establishment is concerned that a Donald Trump could be the nominee. So why even have this discussion in 2015 when these conventions are not for months down the line?
Well, I'm concerned that we have a nominee who's electable. And the law of the way delegates work is that you're bound on the first ballot. So, for example, whoever our nominee is that wins the vote in my district, I'll be voting for them on the first ballot. That's what's required by law. So I don't think it's about the establishment going out to get anybody. What I do think it's about is a very sober understanding that we may have no one that has a majority when they go into the convention, and we want to be going in there eyes wide open so that we're prepared to nominate somebody who can win and lead this country. It matters who our next president is. I want it to be somebody that represents conservative values, and I want it to be somebody who's electable that represents conservative
values. Is that Donald Trump?
You know, Donald Trump, I have come out against much of his rhetoric in recent weeks. I think his rhetoric has been a problem for us. He's going to prove over the coming months whether he's electable. And again, if he gets the majority of the delegate votes, he'll be our nominee. I think we've got a long way between now and then.
Do you fear at all that Donald Trump has already said, because of even the talk of a brokered convention, that he may go rogue, that he may break his promise and become a third-party candidate vis-a-vis Ross Perot? Any concern that if
this talk continues so early on that he may decide, you know what, I'm just going to do what I want to do.
Well, Donald Trump said if he's treated fairly that he would support the Republican nominee out of the convention. I suspect he'll do what he said he will do. What I'm focused on is just making sure that we elect somebody that represents the true values of the Republican Party, and I'm confident we'll do that.
Congressman Luke Messer, thank you so much for joining us on the program. Always appreciate your time.
Yeah,
come back again. Thank you, sir.
Great.
A new poll on support for changes to Indiana's civil rights law. But when will we know Governor Pence's decision on that? Our insiders are here to talk about that and much more. You're watching Indianapolis This Week on RTV6. Everything. Welcome back to Indianapolis This Week. Welcome in our insiders. I'm Lachlan Shabazz, Mary Beth Schneider, and of course, John Zodi, the chair of the Democratic Party, joining us this week. John, thank you for being with us on this Sunday. Let's start by talking about that new poll from the Indianapolis Star, one that finds that 62% of people in Indiana either strongly or somewhat support making it illegal to discriminate against the LGBT community. We also talked to Governor Pence on Thursday. He says that he'll announce something about how he supports, about his support at the beginning of the year. This is an issue that will not go away, obviously, as the legislature gets back to work in a couple of weeks. Mary Beth, what will the governor have to do to put this to rest?
I'm not sure the governor himself can do anything to put it to rest, and the issue is going to stay, I think, potent for a while. The legislature, I don't think, has figured out yet what they want to do about. They have a bill out there that has not drawn real support from either community, people for same-sex marriage and LGBT rights and people opposed. So I had thought maybe they could come in at the beginning, do something quick and get it done. That ain't gonna happen.
Do they need to do that? I mean, does this issue just, I don't want to say go away, but it just seems that this
is the issue going to be addressed. Just like you spoke to the governor this week, talked about...
He told me that he was still praying about it.
He said he was still, you know, walking through, just, you know, continue to listen to both sides. He had both sides of the issue in his office.
And he's talking to people
has spoken
both sides.
To both sides face to face. I do think there will be an agreement, and I do think at the end of the day, it probably will look a lot like Indiana's current civil rights law. The trick is going to be, what do you do about religious institutions and the public accommodation portion of their institutions that don't necessarily involve religion? It's a little complicated, but it's more than just four words in a comma. And if you look at any civil rights statute and the states that passed these things, they also went through this process.
Is it more complicated, John?
Well, no. When the governor purportedly is going to announce his position, we're looking at a timeline of almost 6 months where the governor of Indiana cannot say whether he believes it should be illegal to discriminate against a certain population of people in his state.
But he says
four words in a comma.
Indiana does not discriminate.
It is still legal to do that here in Indiana, and he can't say whether he thinks that's wrong. He says he's been listening and praying and doing all these things while leaders across the board have said it should be illegal to do this in our state, and the governor can't decide. He has been late to the game. He's putting his ideology ahead of the well-being of the state, and this is one more example of how he's doing it.
So is this good for John Gregg, then, the six-month wait? Can John Gregg make something of this in 2016?
Did John Gregg actually write Indiana's original anti-same-sex marriage law?
John Gregg has been very clear that he is for four words and a comma. It should be across-the-board protection. The governor has a problem in that the Senate Republicans put out their bill. Speaker Bosma is being a little cagey on whether he believes something is going to get done. So you don't have agreement across the board from Republicans who lead the effort in the State House. So the Republican supermajorities are in disagreement, and the governor's in disagreement with what is actually going to happen in a very short 10-week session.
And Mary Beth, this is the big issue, that this could sort of derail or take attention away from the other issues. I spoke to Speaker Bosma, who said, look, we're going to get things done no matter what, but this issue could take over the other issues that are so important.
It potentially could, although I think that there is so much momentum also on road funding issues, and the House Republicans put out a pretty serious bill that includes true funding mechanisms, and we've seen something from the governor and something from the House Democrats, so I think that issue has got so much strength of its own that I don't think it can get derailed.
I want to talk about the federal spending bill, a vote on Friday in the U.S. House. Two of Indiana's nine House members voting against the measure, Marlon Stutzman and Todd Young, both candidates for U.S. Senate. They could not come to vote to this bill. Is it political?
Absolutely.
It is 100% political.
100%.
This is textbook Todd Young. When he ran for Congress in 2010, he ran really hard to the right in the primary, tried to go back to the middle, and his claim to be a moderate in Congress, and since he announced his candidacy for the Senate, he's voted to shut down the government when he hasn't done that previously. So Todd Young is absolutely making political moves in Congress right now.
There's always a political element to this, particularly.
And that was a Christmas gift to all of you, by Anthony. That was a dumb question, really.
I mean, yeah. Yeah, let's be honest. It is a political dynamic to it. But the other members, the Republican members of the delegation, did vote for it. They all had issues and problems with certain parts of it. But at the end of the day, this is how government works. You don't get everything you want, and then you go out and you make a decision. Now the government stays open through September.
So is this about the bill, or is this about what you can or not going to get?
It's all those things. And it's also, though, I think about Paul Ryan. He came in as Speaker of the House. This is his first big win. He has shown that they can get something through, and if he can continue that, he's going to be a long-lasting speaker.
I was surprised that he was able to get as many of the Republicans to even agree on a bill, because often it's on party lines, and they just, right?
Yeah, and they also had like 100-something-odd Democrats, too, and the Democrats weren't crazy about the oil embargo lifting and some of the things, but guess what, folks? This is how government works.
You get the last 15 seconds, John Zodi.
Well, like I said, it's a textbook move by Todd Young. Marlon Stutzman voted against it, but he's been consistent in voting against spending bills his entire time.
You must think Todd Young is going to be the nominee.
Yeah, I think my official account, as they keep talking over me, it's okay. It's only Christmas. At the Indy this week is our account for news and updates. You guys can keep talking every day of the week. We'll be right back. Go Colts, and we'll see you right here next Sunday for Indianapolis This Week.